all for coming. Creativity is not mysterious. Creativity is not a big flash of insight that comes to you as a surprise, unexpected, and then it changes the world. It's just the opposite. Creativity is not mysterious. Creativity is a process. It's a way of life. It's a process through time that starts with an idea. But it's not a big idea. It's not a big flash of insight. It's a small idea. A small idea that you and all of us can have every day, many times every day. These small ideas are within our grasp, and psychology research helps us understand how do those ideas happen and how you can have them more often and more effectively. The small idea starts the process, but because it's small, it doesn't solve the problem. Another small idea follows, then another and another and another. It's that process through time that leads to successful creativity. The key to understanding creativity is that it's not linear. It's not a linear process. It's just the opposite. It's a wandering, unpredictable, I call it a zigzagging process. When you start the process, you cannot know where it's going to end up. You can't even know which way it's going, but you have to start. You start the process thinking what you're going to do, what problem you're going to solve, and you engage in the work. Those small ideas come, you engage in the process, you have the habits of mind that creative people engage in. I'll be talking about them tonight. And those steps get you through time. What happens is you take another turn, unexpected. If you're listening to where the ideas go, if you're being aware of what's going on around you, if you're listening to the process itself, what the work is telling you, that directional change will come to you. And it will go in a direction that you're not expecting. But you have to follow that direction. Your direction will change many times. And if you're not changing direction, you're trying to make that process linear. And if it's linear, it will not be as creative. So those are the two key messages I have for you from the research. One is the process is not linear. It's a wandering process through time. The second message is it's small ideas that drive the process forward. So if you can learn how to have the small ideas, and you learn how to connect the ideas through time, then you've mastered the art of creativity. The good news is that psychology research now helps us understand how you can do that. I've got a series of exercises I'll be guiding you through tonight that are based in that research that guide you to engage in a process that's much more like the way exceptional creators behave, the way they get to their exceptional successes. I'm going to start with a story, the story of a very successful invention that came from this nonlinear process. How many of you have this app on your smartphone? Raise your hand. It was not a successful app, so no one has it on their smartphone. I'm not surprised. So yes, you don't have it, I don't have it, I never had it. This came out in 2010, developed by a programmer named Kevin Systrom. It's called Bourbon. It's called Bourbon because Kevin liked whiskey. He loved to drink whiskey, so he said it has nothing to do with drinking. By the way, it's not an app that tracks your alcohol. Anyway, yes, that would be useful too. But no, Bourbon has nothing to do with drinking. It was a location sharing app. This was 2010. And location sharing was the rage. Everybody with their GPS on their smartphone, they wanted to check in, right? You go to Starbucks, your friends, of course they want to know that you're at Starbucks. So you go on, you check in. Everyone has followed you or friended you in the app. Oh, you know, Keith is at Starbucks. I'm not far from Starbucks. I'm going. But, you know, the location sharing trend. That was 2010. And Kevin Systrom said, I want a piece of that location sharing app business. It only took him 4 months to develop this all by himself, right? Bourbon. If you're a pretty good programmer, not so hard. So he releases the app. It actually had some avid followers that downloaded Bourbon. They were using location sharing There was a feature where you could develop a list, a plan for your day. You could share that. He threw in a photo sharing feature because smartphones just were starting to have cameras. So he's got so much in it, it just confused people. Bourbon was not very successful. So he sat down, he got another programmer involved. The two of them started analyzing the usage data. They said, what are people doing with bourbon? Why aren't they downloading bourbon more often? What they saw was nobody was checking in, but lots of people were sharing photos. They're thinking, oh, you know what? We probably have just asked the wrong question. We're trying to solve the wrong problem. The world does not need another location sharing app, but maybe what we should be trying to do is develop a better photo sharing app. So they did a bunch of programming. They stripped out everything else. They said, it's not location sharing anymore. It's now photo sharing. And we're going to make it the best photo sharing app we know how to do. They reprogrammed everything. They made it the photo sharing app. And they re-released it under a different name. Instagram. So how many people know of or have Instagram? Yeah, it's like everybody, right? Hugely successful app. Later sold to Facebook, Yahoo, Facebook, right? Facebook is buying everything. Of course it's Facebook. So yes, this is an example of the success of that wandering, unpredictable path. You start thinking you're doing a location sharing app, right? And turns out that's not really what the question should be. You are asking the wrong question. If you're receptive to what's happening and what's responding to you in the environment, then you discover where you really should be going. It should be a photo sharing app. So it's that shift in direction, the zigzagging path. It's often called the pivot in Silicon Valley. And it's pretty typical. It's conventional wisdom, in fact, that every company that's successful has gone through a pivot. When I look at the creative process, I find it everywhere, not just in startups in Silicon Valley. And also, it's not just one pivot, right? It continues over and over throughout the process. That's why I like to think of it as a zigzag. It's pivots in a row. And when you look at applications that aren't software, right, it's musical composition, it's creative writing, it's theater, it's artwork or design, anything involving that type of creativity, it's even more likely to have lots and lots of small ideas over time and lots of changes in direction. I've organized all this research into a couple of habits of mind that incredibly successful people engage in. The first one I'm going to talk about tonight I call ask. Asking really good questions. Now, if you know what your question is, you have a problem, right? You have a problem, you don't know how to solve it, you think it's going to require creativity. So you start working on the problem, and if you get in a linear path to a solution, that's great. It may have required creativity to get to that point, and it's been linear. But we call that, in psychology research, we call it problem-solving creativity. But there's another kind of creativity that's even more likely to lead to exceptional creativity. And we call that problem-finding creativity. That's where you don't know what the problem is yet. You're not really sure how to formulate the question. You have a sense, you have an intuition, but you really don't know what problem you need to be solving. And if you've come on that problem, we call it finding a problem, right? Or formulating a problem in a different way. You may be formulating, you may be thinking about your problem in a way that's not productive, that will lead you to a solution that's not the most creative solution. So this problem-finding process leads to the most exceptional creativity. Bourbon to Instagram, that's a great example. And by the way, zigzagging path, it didn't go straight from bourbon to Instagram either. There was an intermediate app released that was called, anyone guess, Scotch. So yes, so Scotch was buggy, it wasn't very successful either. Every story behind every successful innovation, it works that way. You scratch beneath the surface, you see all the steps that once it's released and successful, you forget that, right? You think it's a big flash. That's the reason why, right? We think that because you and I, who are the users, the consumers, the audience, we don't see the wandering, zigzagging process that really was behind the work. I have a set of techniques you can engage in that will help you ask better questions. Questions that are more likely to lead to creative outcomes. One of the techniques is, in a way it's pretty straightforward, if you want to get good at asking questions, then ask a lot of questions. So one activity, I call it try 10 questions. And I ask you to think of an everyday common object, like a cardboard box, anything like that. Maybe it's a coin, a dime. So let's say it's a cardboard box. And your exercise is to ask 10 questions about cardboard boxes. Now it has to be 10 because the first four or five questions you ask about any common object, they're going to be obvious questions that just about anyone would have thought of. Right? So cardboard boxes, actually, I haven't come up with my list of 10, but so think about a question, and I'm thinking about, I don't know, why are they made of cardboard? Why do people use them instead of something else? See, I'm doing really bad at this. But if I came up with four questions, I bet, how many of you were thinking, why are they made of cardboard? Someone throw out a question.
Why are they brown?
Okay, good.
What dimensions?
What dimensions? There you go. Okay, so.
How did it get started?
Who invented them? Yeah, okay. Why? What's that? Oh, wait, you already said something.
Why is it rectangular?
And exactly, why is it a rectangle? Could be a sphere, a circle. Right, so anyway, it doesn't matter what the questions are, but the key is to get to 10, because the first four or five is going to be hard. I mean, 10 questions about cardboard boxes, I couldn't even come up with two up on stage. But that's the purpose of the exercise, to force yourself to ask those questions. And when you get to 10, you're going to be asking questions that you never thought of, and probably no one else in the room would be thinking of those questions. So yeah, that's just a common everyday activity. You can do it any day. Keep yourself asking questions. Another one that I got this one from Chicago Improv Theater. And Chicago Improv Theater, of course, it's New York Improv Theater. It's all over the world now. It's an activity, it's a game in Chicago Improv Theater. They call it the world's worst. And they say, they get up on stage and say, we're gonna do world's worst. World's worst way to do what? They get a suggestion from the audience. What's the world's worst way to?
Come on, shut up.
To order pizza?
Eat a pizza.
To eat a pizza. World's worst way to eat a pizza. And then two people start improvising the scene where they're doing something hilarious that's really stupid about eating pizza. Right, I'm not gonna do that. But ask yourself, what's the world's worst way to propose marriage? I'm not even gonna ask you. And what's the world's worst way to ask your boss for a raise? So anything, you get the idea. So think of world's worst way to do something. And of course, they're gonna be horrible ideas. Too embarrassing to share them tonight. But it's, again, going to stretch your ability to think of new ways of formulating a problem, new ways to ask questions. Because what you're really doing is forcing yourself to think about the problem in a very different way than you would have before. And that's the source of problem-finding creativity, is that ability to think about problems in a completely different way. Another activity, and I've done this in a Professor Kavanaugh class earlier today, it's a sketching activity. You will have to do this in your head because you're not sitting at tables. But it comes from a psychology experiment where some researchers at University of Texas, Austin, and they said, pick three of these shapes. Pick any three shapes you want. You can do it right now, do it in your head. So everybody pick three shapes. Random choices. Pick three shapes, and then what you're asked to do, this is a psychology experiment really about the creative process, combine the three shapes in your head, get them combined together in some way, a creative way, right, to create an invention that is interesting and potentially useful. Interesting and potentially useful. And you'll be doing it in your mind's eye. Of course, doing it on paper with pencil is better. And I'll only give you a couple of seconds. Of course, if you had more time, you can do this after I'm done tonight. So in this psychology experiment, everyone who came into the lab had come up with a sketch, right? Just like perhaps you have in your mind. Then they were given a surprise. The surprise was the invention category. They were randomly assigned the invention category, and they said to the inventor, you have to reinterpret your sketch. What you just drew, it has to be in this category. So come up with a story about how your invention really is a scientific instrument. You cannot redraw it, right? So it turns out this is pretty hard. A lot of the people who came into the lab just couldn't do it. And they checked the box, right? Can't do it. And that was recorded in the scientific experiment. But a lot of people were able to reinterpret their invention. And it turns out these are the most creative inventions, as rated by, I think they were mechanical engineering professors, compared to any other form of invention, creating these three shapes, coming up with a reinterpretation after you've already come up with the sketch results in greater creativity. And it goes with the same principle. You're forced to reformulate the problem. You're forced to ask yourself a question that you would not have thought of asking without this activity. This is a critical step in the creative process, is coming up with this new kind of problem and being receptive as you're engaged in the process to a new problem emerging. And that's the nature of the creative process when it's not linear, when it's wandering and unpredictable. It's often going to go in a different direction than you were expecting. It can be unnerving. It can be scary, right? Because people like certainty. People like knowing where they're going to go. In the creative process, because it's unpredictable and it's wandering, honestly, you don't know when it's going to end. And that can be very disturbing, right? Especially if you have a deadline. So yes, you can't know. You can't know when it's going to end. So yes, this is a critical part of the creative process. I'm going to move on to a second set of habits that exceptional creators engage in, and I call it look. It's a form of awareness, of mindfulness. It's a way of perceiving the world, a type of openness which most of us are so focused on our day. We have something to do, we have a meeting to get to, we're late to get to the office or the class, so we don't have time to be aware of what's going on around us. There's a researcher in England, his name is Richard Wiseman, and I love this guy's research because he's been studying for many years. He's been debunking, for the most part, debunking hoaxes. For example, people who claim they've, can see the future, and they have, or magicians, right? Magicians, and they have these tricks. So he goes in and he debunks people who say they have these special powers, right? And he can demonstrate. So one thing he was interested in as part of this research, lucky people. And he said, so he wanted to find out who's lucky. Some lucky people just think they don't know why they're lucky, right? Unlucky people. So he got people to report from a 1 to 10 scale, how lucky would you say you are? If you're incredibly lucky, luckier than everyone you know, give yourself a 10. If your life is miserable and you're the least lucky person you know, give yourself a 1. Okay, you all do that right now. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. Don't think too hard about it. So you've got a number. So if you picked a number between 6 and 10, raise your hand. And if you picked a number between 1 and 5, raise your hand. So it's a pretty even split, which is, I guess that's pretty typical. So this is Richard Wiseman's research. And what he was interested in is the comparison between the 10s and the 1s. So he got them all into his lab, the 10s and the 1s, and he asked a whole bunch of things about these people, about daily habits they engage in, about things that happen to them. I won't tell you right away, but I want to show you one of his experiments. One of his experiments was he gave each person, they were each alone, okay, one at a time. He gave each person the first section of the newspaper. Right? So they got a newspaper, and Wiseman says, I want you to count the number of photos in this newspaper. And I want you to do it as fast as you can. So when you're finished, let me know and tell me the number. So he's got a stopwatch. He's timing. How fast are they taking? So the unlucky people, right, looking through the newspaper, they get to the end, 43 photos. You have the stopwatch, 15 seconds on air. Okay, that's the unlucky people. Going through the paper, counting up 43 photos. Then he gives the newspaper to the lucky people. And the lucky people, on average, he gets a stopwatch, they start looking through the newspaper, they count the photos in 1 second. Oh, that's impossible, right? Because it was a trick newspaper with this on the second inside page. So, the unlucky people looked right by this. And why? Because they're looking for photos. You don't see text. That could be me, right? Could be you. But the lucky people, they saw it. And that was a contrast between the 10s and the 1s. So Weissman did a whole bunch of experiments like this, right? And what he finds is that lucky people are better at noticing things they're not looking for. They have that awareness, that mindfulness, where they'll see things that if you're focused on your task, you don't see them. So the lucky people, this happens over and over again when Weissman gives these tests. Lucky people are more likely to notice things. They're more likely to introduce change into their daily routines in a conscious fashion. They're more likely to meet people more often, a variety of people. And the good news, I think, is that they're more relaxed about life. So yeah, I want to be one of the lucky people, right? But these point of Weissman's research is being lucky is not magical, right? It's a set of practices that you can engage in. It's the same message I'm giving you about creativity in a way, right? This is one of the habits that creative people engage in. It's this awareness, this mindfulness that you get through the day every day. You are thinking about being aware. And there are a couple of exercises you can do. Here's one of them that I think of from my research is to pick a shape of the day. Pick a shape in the morning, geometric shape, square, circle, triangle, maybe a zigzag. And as you go through the day, look for things that are shaped that way. And you know, notice them, right? Notice them. You're looking around, you're looking for circles. Instead of looking down at the sidewalk, instead of looking at your watch, instead of checking your text message, right? You're aware because you're looking for the circle. Now circles, you're gonna see a lot of circles. You're gonna see a lot of squares. So once you do this a couple of times, you're gonna wanna pick some more unusual shapes, right? Maybe a semicircle, maybe a trapezoid. And then you're looking a little bit harder. That's the key, is to get into that mindset of being aware of noticing things that are not part of what you're actively focusing on. Another exercise that I like to help people out with is called spot the spandrel. Now, anybody who's an architect in here, the spandrel is the architect's term for a shape that's created as a side effect of something else. So this is from classic architecture. You're building an arch. You build the arch and sort of by necessity leaves these little triangle things on top of it. So the artists and the architects came up with decorative patterns they put in the spandrel to make it look like it's supposed to be there, but really it's just a side effect of the arch. So as you go through your day, look for spandrels. Look for anything that's there, not really by design, but by a side effect something else that's designed. Something I always notice, because I'm at the airport a lot, in between the parking garage and the road that gets you to the parking garage, there's this 2-foot stretch of mud filled with trash, people's discarded coat cans. Okay, that's a spandrel, right? Anything that's there, not for itself, right? But as a side effect of something else. Go through your day looking for these. As a matter of fact, right here, pretty much every auditorium, every space, every hall will have a spandrel. So yeah, look around, try to find one as you're leaving tonight. You'll find a spandrel. It's the same thing, good. It's the same principle of doing these exercises that are more likely to increase your awareness, your ability to spot things around you in the world. The reason why that helps you so much with creativity is based on a body of research of mental combinations. Pretty much all ideas are combinations of existing ideas. right? Concepts, perceptions. You're combining things that are already in your mind every time you have a new idea. It's an association. And most people, they're combining things that are in their mind. Their mind's filled with material that's pretty similar, right? Because we're focused. We have a disciplinary area. We have a college major. We have a job. Our minds are filled with very similar stuff. That's the way we are. We're focused. We have a body of expertise. So when we're making these combinations, the combinations are between very similar material. But the most creative ideas, we know from research, are combinations of very distant, very different kinds of material. We call them distant combinations. Psychologists come up with these terms. Sometimes we call them remote associations. Distant combinations. So you're combining concepts that are very different from each other. That's more likely to be a surprising and creative idea. So you're going for those distant combinations. If your mind is filled with all of the same stuff, how can you have, you can't have the distant combination. So the point of these exercises of awareness is that it brings things into your mind that are not what you're focused on. They're not part of your daily practice. You're, in a sense, you're, I shouldn't say forcing yourself, but you're helping yourself to get that material into your mind, and you're preparing yourself to make those distant combinations, right? It's like a lot of these exercises. You're not going to have the idea 5 minutes later, right? You're putting this stuff in your mind, and it's going to enhance your creativity indefinitely. You don't know how long it's going to be before that distant combination is going to happen. You engage in the practices in anticipation. You begin to trust the process because you don't have an immediate benefit, right? But once you've gone through the process a certain number of weeks, for months, for years, and you start to see it pay off, exceptional creators, serial creators, they trust the process because they've seen it work. So it takes a little bit of time to build up confidence, because at first, I'm wasting my time, I'm not getting anything out of this, I've got this job I need to do, and you stop, right? You stop engaging in the activities. You have to engage in them for at least some period of time before you start to get the benefit. You're investing. You're investing in a life of creativity. The third practice I'm going to talk about, I call it choosing. It's not so much really giving an up or down vote, but you're going to have lots of ideas. Once you start to engage in these practices, you'll have ideas every day, 10, 20 ideas. You'll have ideas every week. Could be 100 ideas every week. You're going to be having ideas all the time. And by the way, everyone should carry a notebook with them. All this creativity advice in the book. You got to take something with you that's ready to hand, where you can record these small ideas that you're having all the time. You should be going for 10 ideas a day, 100 ideas a week, right? You're not going to remember all of those ideas. You got to have somewhere to record them. And then at the end of the week, you're looking through your list of ideas. If you wait till the end of the month, you've got hundreds of ideas. So you're always generating ideas. You're always reflecting on the ideas. That reflection is a key part of the creative process. When you're reflecting on the ideas, then you start to think about, how can I make this idea better? What's interesting about this idea? This idea, I don't think this is going anywhere, but there's something intriguing about it. I think I should think about it a little bit. So you're taking each of those ideas, even the ideas that you know are not going to get you to the end point, but you think there's something interesting about the idea. So you focus on it a little bit more. It's that ability to take the benefits and use it to drive the process forward. I'll give you an example of a company that's one of the most innovative companies in America. It actually was voted the most innovative company in America by Fast Company magazine a few years ago. And it's a company most people don't think about. The name of the company is W.L. Gore. Gore. I'm seeing puzzled looks on your faces. Gore, if you've heard of it at all, Gore is known as the inventor of a waterproof valve called Gore-Tex. Gore-Tex, that's their best known product. But what most people don't know is that it's a serial innovator. They got hundreds of innovations in something like 15 different industry sectors. So fabrics, Gore-Tex, is only one of many. They've got a huge medical products business. Medical products are out in Flagstaff, Arizona. there was a guy named Dave Myers who was working on medical products in Flagstaff. And the key about Gore, they have a policy where every employee gets 10% of their time every week to work on something wild and crazy and creative. Anything you want. So Dave Meyer had used his 10% time to invent a new kind of mountain biking cable. Because outside of Flagstaff, Arizona, there's a lot of mountain biking trails, but they're dusty and it's deserty, right? So this dust gets all over your cables and it interferes with the shifting and the braking. So he had coated his wire cables with this friction-free substance that made them shift really well. And he's thinking, what am I gonna do now in my 10% time? I think this coated wire with friction-free substance on it, I think it could be useful for something else. Something totally different, but what could I use this for? And, you know, what could I use a friction-free coated wire for? I'll get some suggestions.
Telephone lines so snow falls off?
I love it, yeah. Telephone lines so snow falls off, sure. I mean, imagine you're gonna be thinking of lots of things. You've got 10% of every week to work on. So, yeah, so throw them out. We'll hear some more. This side of the room. I'm going to call on somebody. Okay, you're thinking of something.
Not
me. You're not thinking of something? Okay, right behind you. Come on. All right, you got to think harder. I'm going to call on you next.
Cable, different cable of a medical situation.
I said medical products, so like to do what?
Well, any medical device that has a cable or wire that you want to test or any viruses or whatever.
Sure, right. Yeah, we don't know human bodies, but sure. Lots of things. Sure.
A cutting tool, like a chainsaw or something.
Sure, absolutely. Right. Like, this is the whole point, is to toss out ideas. Who knows? They might be horrible, right?
Like a retractable.
There you go. See, it could be anything. Right, right. So I'm not up here to evaluate your ideas. Maybe that's why you're hesitant. But none of you, I guarantee none of you, have thought of what Dave Meyer came up with. Because it is so strange. His idea was puppet control cables. Right, you're like, what? Puppets? Imagine Chuck E. Cheese restaurant. So he was at a Chuck E. Cheese, his son's birthday party. And he sees these animated rats up on, or what are they? They're rats, right? Animated animals are up on stage, and he's like looking at them. They're kind of creaky, they're kind of old looking. It's like, they are controlled by cables. The puppet control cable industry is ripe for transformation. So that's his insight. And he spends 10% of every week on puppet control cables. And guess what? After 6 months, he realizes it's a bad idea. The world does not need new puppet control cables, right? I guess just like bourbon, right? You've been asking the wrong question. But he engaged in this set of practices. He said, still, there's something interesting about this idea. He had been using a friend's old guitar strings for his prototype puppet control cables. He was not a guitarist, but he started thinking, he's looking at his pile of wasted prototypes guitar strings. He says, maybe this would make a good guitar string. So he starts asking his guitarist friends, and they say, oh, as a matter of fact, yeah, having my strings coated, that would make them last, you know, like five times as long. The oils from my fingers wouldn't get in them, little flecks of dead skin. All this stuff deadens the sound of your strings. You have to get a new string. So Dave Meyer starts working on a guitar string idea. Turns out to be a huge success, right? He releases a new guitar string, or Gore. It's called Elixir. Elixir brand. Usually if there are guitarists in the audience, you know, you have used this brand of guitar string. Within a year, it was the best-selling guitar string in the United States. Within 1 year of its release. And it's an example of the creative process. It's wandering, it's unpredictable, you're aware of what's going on around you, and you're receptive to new questions emerging. He used guitar strings for his puppet cable prototypes, and it was purely by accident that they were guitar strings, by the way. And he knew nothing about guitar, but looking at the cables, thinking about, it's all of the features I've been talking about tonight that led to this incredibly successful innovation. but it also has the characteristics that make people nervous. You don't know what you're doing. You don't know when the process will end. You don't know how many failures you're going to have along the way. And you're thinking now, I'm thinking too, puppet control cables, that's a horrible idea. Come on, you're working in the medical products industry. They make tons of money on their stuff, I assume. Yeah. Medical products, huge business. And puppet, Chuck E. Cheese. Anyway, it sounds stupid now, but at the time he thought it was a great idea. And who knew, right? It might have turned out to be a great idea. But that's the nature of the creative process. You don't know, and you can't know, but you have to engage in the process anyway. Because if you don't engage in the process, then nothing will happen. Someone like Dave Meyer, he's been working in an environment, he's been doing this for years. He came up with a Ryon brand of bicycle cables in his 10% time. So you get to the point where you trust the process, even though when you're starting, and you're starting a life of creativity, if you're not there already, but if you're just engaging in this process of enhancing your personal creativity, it's going to be unnerving. It's going to be a little frightening. Once you have a few successes, then you learn to trust that process. Here's something you can do with other people. It's particularly good in a group. When you have lots and lots of ideas, and you're having them all the time, you're going to have trouble figuring out making sense out of them, right? You've got 100 ideas, let's say you wrote them down in your book. One technique that I love is called the affinity diagram. And some of you may have done this. This might look familiar. And this is why it's great for a group, is because you put each idea on a separate post-it note. And now you've got lots of post-it notes. You stick them all up on a whiteboard or on the wall. If you've got a bunch of different people, this works great because you can all go stick them up together. And then you've got 100 post-it notes. Then what you do is you start moving the post-it notes, putting them next to other notes that they seem similar to. So you're putting together post-it notes that have a relationship. And the ideas that are somehow linked together start to be grouped together up on your wall. And after, it could take 30 minutes, depending on how many notes you have, especially works well in a group, you end up with clusters. The notes form into clusters. In most cases when I've seen this or facilitated this, it's usually about 5 or 6 clusters that end up on the board. And that ends up being powerful because the clusters have meaning that no one person would have spotted ahead of time. You start to realize the collective genius of the group. And then you think about, what is this cluster? What does it mean? It really helps to give every cluster a name. Write the name on the whiteboard. And then seeing those clusters supports this process of creative reflection I've been talking about. It's that ability to reflect on your process and think about, what was I doing? What really was important about this? And where could it be going in the future? This is an example of that type of activity that drives the process forward, the affinity diagram. The final activity I'm going to talk about today, I call it making, or picking the best ideas and making them even better. A huge body of research that shows if you externalize your ideas into something tangible in the world, that enhances your creativity. Keeping it inside your mind, not the best way to be creative. Sitting in a room by yourself thinking, that is not the way creative people perform. You have to engage in making things. You have to externalize your ideas into the world. And when I say externalize, I mean, it's meant to be a very general term. If you're a writer, you need to start writing. You might not even know what book you're writing or whether it's crap, right? You just have to write every day. If you're a musician, it's the same way. You've got to sit there and play hours a day, right? In my case, I'm a writer, a scientific writer. I write all sorts of stuff that goes nowhere. I end up deleting 90% of everything I write. That's the nature of the creative process, is to get things out there in the world. And then those things talk back to you. You have a conversation with what's come out of you. It takes on its own life. And then what happens is, what you make often isn't what you thought you were making. So then you're looking at it, saying, wait a minute, that's not what I thought I was making, but why did I make that? And what happens is you start to spot the assumptions you were making that you didn't realize you were having. So this process of making again, it leads to that creative reflection on your own process. It leads you to see things you would not have seen otherwise. The importance of externalizing things into the world. Here's an activity that I do that helps me with this kind of externalizing of my ideas. Now this, I live in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, and this is my local airport, the Raleigh-Durham Airport. If you've ever been in an airport, you have seen this newsstand, right? It's the same in every airport. So I just pulled out my cell phone and I took a picture of the newsstand as I was flying here yesterday. That's the newsstand. And then what I advise you to do is to go to the newsstand and buy five magazines. But they have to be magazines that you have no sense whatsoever and that you've never, ever paid attention to. I have the five I bought here. Should have pulled them out ahead of time. So yeah, I tore off the covers. I'm not going to show you the stuff I tore out of the middle. So the key is go through these magazines and find photos that seem interesting to you for some reason. Who knows why? You just have an intuition. And you're going to take all these photos and you're going to make a collage. So here are the magazines that I got. And you'll be able to tell a little bit about me, at least the things I don't care about. Should say don't care about, but that I know nothing about. First one, Better Homes and Gardens. You can laugh if you want. Golf Digest, Popular Mechanics, Road and Track Magazine, and Ebony Magazine. So all things I don't know anything about. But that's the key, right? You start to notice things in each magazine. I start to notice things like Road and Track. Every photo is of a car. Who knew? I'm thinking, even if you like cars a lot, do you really want every photo? Okay. So then you start thinking, if you love this magazine, each car looks different. So they're seeing the magazine in a different way. So then you start, well, what are they seeing? And you start to go through that habit of noticing things. But anyway, that's a side effect of the magazine activity. I cut out the pictures, I go back, and I put them all together in a collage. And that may sound odd, but it's one way of externalizing the thoughts that are in your mind. But externalizing them in a way that's not obvious. The key is to draw out the things that you're thinking, but that you don't know you're thinking. Right? So this activity of making the collage is one example of that. Any activity, and I have quite a few activities in each of these four habits of mine in my book, it's for sale in the back. Also in a card deck that I developed with 52 activities. And the ones I've told you about tonight are individual cards in the card deck. Each of these four I've told you about are all involved in the exceptional process of creativity. These are all things that are based in research. They're all things that exceptional creators do every day. They engage in a process that's wandering through time, that has lots of small ideas in it, that eventually leads to the successful outcome. It's never about the big flash of insight, right? If you're thinking it's the big flash, then you will get sad and depressed because you're not going to have the big flash of insight. And you're looking at these famous creators through history, and you know, that person, whoever, Alexander Graham Bell, he had the big idea and now he's rich because he invented the telephone. No, he did not have the big flash of insight. We read these stories even when we're children, right? So-and-so invented this, he was off in the woods, or she was in the kitchen, whatever. Sorry, I'm being all stereotypical. But yes, wherever, alone, suddenly having a big flash of insight and then becoming famous and rich, and now we're reading about them in the history book. And I have not come up with that idea, so I'm not good. Right? The myth of insight is debilitating because you're going to think you're not creative because you're not having the big flash. But the secret is nobody has the big flash. Everybody who's successfully creative engages in these habits of mind that are within our grasp. Everyone has these mental capabilities to have these small ideas and to manage that process through time. I'm going to leave you with one activity that, you could do it in here. I was going to say, do it on your way out. I want you to write a song. And write a song about your problem, your creative challenge. But first, pick a melody. Pick a common song, like Happy Birthday. Something like Happy Birthday, a melody that everybody knows. And then put your problem into verse. And, you know, I'm not a songwriter. Most of you are not songwriters. But you put that out there in words. And as you're leaving tonight, sing your song. And this is, I call this technique, I put it in the habit of making ideas. It's a way of getting your ideas out into the world. But each of these exercises shares a characteristic that they lead you to externalize your ideas in a way different from what you normally might do. Like most of us, including me, if you told me to externalize my idea, I would write down, here is my idea, it's to do this. Right? And that's not going to lead you to maximum creativity. These exercises will help you externalize your ideas in ways that get around those implicit assumptions that you don't realize you're having. So much of creativity is challenging yourself, getting you beyond your assumptions, what you take for granted, what's easy for you. Creativity is not easy. I guess that's the bad news I haven't told you about yet. Exceptional creators work really hard at being creative. The myth of insight makes creativity seem like it's easy. It's easy for that person who had the brilliant insight. I don't have the brilliant insight. Not easy for me. I'm not creative. It's a cop-out, right? If creativity is easy, then everybody would be creative. Creativity is hard work. And any exceptional creator will tell you that. In fact, I've gone out and I've interviewed artists and designers, and they are really resentful at the myth of insight. Because everybody else thinks creativity is so easy for them. And they feel like this is insulting. They think, my life is easy because I'm creative, I can paint all these paintings. No, I worked my ass off to paint these paintings. This was hard work. It's the same process I've been telling you about. Lots of small ideas through time. You make something crappy, you got to paint over it, then you throw the canvas away, right? And then you take it out of the trash, and holy shit, that piece over there was really good. It's the same in every creative domain. So that's the bad news I've told you, that creativity is hard work. But the good news is, creativity is a habit and a set of practices which are within your grasp. Anyone can engage in these creative practices. Anyone can have those small ideas. Anyone can master the process, the wandering, zigzagging, unpredictable process that leads to successful creativity. So that's the powerful message, is that you can be more creative. Any one of us have that mental capability of all of the most exceptional creators. So go out there and be creative. Thank you. So I think we're going to do Q&A.
Yes.
I can pop on down for this.
And I think there are microphones available.
Oh, yes, there is a microphone. So
if you just raise your hands. If you
the have microphone it. Will be used for the cameras, so don't try to shout without the microphone. But you can shout at her and give me the microphone.
Question?
Okay, up in front. It's your choice whether you stand up.
My question is, how did you come about this process yourself?
How did I come
up? You uncovered this before you knew these steps. How did you come across or come about uncovering these practices for your creativity?
Right. Thank you. So the question is, how did I come up with the steps? And it's a great question. Maybe, why should you trust me, right?
No.
I'm rhetorically not saying you. I grounded them in scientific research. So I am a scientist, I'm a psychological researcher. So, I just have this belief that everything I say should be grounded in research. Other people who talk about creativity, a lot of people are creators who've done it, and I love listening to their stories. But maybe their stories are idiosyncratic, maybe they only work for them. Usually they're general messages, but in my case, I'm not talking about me or my creativity. I'm talking about the huge body of research on creativity. In 2006, And then again in 2012, I wrote a textbook overview of creativity research. So basically, I had to read everything that all my colleagues had done. And all of this research on creativity, all of these experiments like the 15 shape activity, Richard Wiseman's luck research. So I was putting it on, you know, this on the floor, and it turned out that all of this research fell into eight categories. And so that's how I came up with the eight steps, or the eight habits of mind of exceptional creators. Tonight I only told you about four, but in my book there are eight. And there are other creativity researchers who might say four or five. I think there's one who said, you know, 12. So eight to me seemed like the right amount. And it works really well for enhancing your own creativity. I've learned that if you put them in these eight groups. So I hope that answers your question. Thanks.
Oh. I have two questions. One is, do you align any of your research with positive psychology with, you know, UPenn's work on positive thinking and behavior?
Oh, absolutely, yes. So she refers to positive psychology, which is what Marty Seligman and then my advisor, Mike Csikszentmihalyi, are considered the two founders of positive psychology. Basically, a response to a long tradition in psychology focused on therapy, or psychotherapy, and then diagnosis and understanding of mental illnesses and disabilities. And this new movement, not new anymore, I mean, I got to University of Chicago in 1990. That's when my advisor, Mike Csikszentmihalyi, wrote his famous book called Flow. Maybe the older folks in the audience may remember that book. Millions of copies were sold. It's a book about optimal experience, about people when they're at their best. So this is a landmark in positive psychology. Now we're talking about human flourishing. And creativity is a big part of this movement to positive psychology because, right, creativity is people at their best, people doing awesome things. So yes, absolutely.
And then another question is, do you, I hear about creating things, but what about career choices, career changes, adapting to the changes that we have to do when we're in our 30s, 40s, 60s in career?
Exactly, so we're creating a life, right? Mm-hmm. Wait, there's a name, Mary Catherine Basin. Does anyone have that book called Creating a Life? I think it's Mary Catherine Basin, but there is a book. I used to read, I guess I still do read occasionally, Business Week magazine. I'm going somewhere with this. So Business Week magazine, on the very last page, right before the back cover, they did a story of someone who's been very successful, not just in business, but in academia or creativity. And what they did is they have a timeline from the top of the page to the bottom. And the top of the page starts with where you were born, where you went to high school, then it talks about your first job, this person's first job out of college, and all the way down to where they are now. Every single one of those stories is zigzag. Not a single person gets their college degree in biology and then gets a PhD in biology. And now at the age of 55, they're a famous organic biologist. Not a single one, nobody. Every single one of them, I mean, the line goes up, but it's the zigzagging path through life. So I see that, I wanted to call up whoever does that feature and co-author my next book. Life is zigzagging, right? So yeah, great question. Sounds like you've done it yourself. I certainly have, you know, being 56. So if you're younger here, be welcoming to that. Don't try to do the same thing for the next 4 years. You're finding the problem, right? The problem of who you are.
Okay, so I had a question about sort of reinforcement for creativity, and this is coming. I've got a friend and her husband. He was an Imagineer at Disney World, at Disneyland for 6 years, and he just did a board game, and he designs video games. But when he started working at Disneyland, I'm like, okay, like 97% of what you do is going to be thrown straight in the trash bin. So we have a lot of burnout here because we've got all these creative people, we collect them, and then we kind of basically stomp them down into the dust. So is there any research on those kinds of phenomena?
What, you mean failure? Or
well,
sucking?
But kind of like this idea that you're consciously finding the most creative people possible, and then like what happens to them if they're kind of faced with continuous ongoing failure.
Right. Okay, first of all, number one is I would say there isn't such a thing as creative people. That's a sort of myth that, I mean, we all get this in high school, right?
or someone who's really good at drawing, that's the creative person, or someone who's big into music. But yes, so there are certain people who choose creative careers, and so they choose to go CalArts or SCAD, and they get their BFA in graphic design, or the MFA in what do they call video games now? Movement design. Yeah, so these are the people they're hiring, and yes, I agree, they are very creative. And the companies that are successful at creating understand the process I'm talking about, right? And the people in them also understand this is the process. It's wandering, it's unpredictable, you don't know where it's going, and you don't know where it's going to end, and a lot of it, 97%. What CEO of the design firm said something about sucking? Him or someone famous, is it Pixar, is it IDEO?
I heard something.
Right, we're trying to get from suck to not suck. I think it's the same. Yeah, so most of it's going to be horrible. So how do you survive through that? Honestly, if they are creative people, as you say, they're already going to know that by the time they start. But then what you're talking about is organizational culture. And that requires a certain kind of leadership. It requires a culture through the organization of welcoming failure and not being punished. Because you're right. If you're in a creative company and it's successful, then the leaders of that company should understand that this is the nature of the creative process. And then, yes, you can't stomp them down. The language you're using makes me think, ooh, that would suck to live there. This is someone you know who worked there who said they got stomped down.
So
that's awful.
Okay, so I feel like I'm doing a poor job semantically here. So creative people probably should have been in quotes because they're
I understand.
But what, so the psychology of it, from what I understood him to be relating, is that these are people who have lived their lives being very creative, they've been very successful in this creativity, and now they move for the first time into an environment where there's kind of a 98% failure rate. So that failure rate is in and of itself is the stopping. So it's independent of management or organizational culture, because I mean, any of the publications from this particular culture where you meet folks who are successful in the culture, obviously they know that this is the case.
Right.
So it's just this kind of, you're starting to lack reinforcement from the creative successes you had in the past.
Right, so right. So yeah, thank you, I appreciate that. No, my comment wasn't for you.
It's okay.
But yeah, so my response is it's hard. You're talking about organizations and organizational culture. And I often am invited to speak to senior executives about how to create an innovative organization. So yeah, it's the responsibility of the leaders of the organization. And if you can't create a culture where people feel good about that, because that's the way it's going to happen, then those people are going to be miserable and they're going to leave. And honestly, I don't think the company would thrive. I mean, this is Disney, which has been very successful. But Pixar, within Disney now, is exactly like what I'm describing. Every single movie from Pixar that many of you have seen always is zigzagging wandering path to the movie that you saw. I often tell the story of Toy Story, the first Pixar film, which is incredibly wandering and zigzagging. And maybe we're hoping, actually the people at Pixar tend to be critical of Disney who purchased them. So maybe there is a divide in culture. Anyway, I'd have to learn more about Disney.
So I'm just wondering about any connections with research to support some correlation of creativity with some attributes like risk-taking or curiosity.
Absolutely. I mean, it seems like what I'm talking about, right? A lot of what I describe is curiosity, but I talk about it as awareness or mindfulness. And then we talked about risk-taking. Yeah, I think that's a good way to think about creativity. I tend to think more about habits and behaviors because I believe with these exercises, I believe you can make yourself more creative. So I'm not sure I think it's a personality trait that you're a creative or you're a curious person or not. So I'm a little nervous about that, but of course some people are more curious, so we can say that's a trait of them. But I think any of us could become more curious.
And I guess about curiosity, just my own experience, that it seems to me that people are they're often interested in many things.
Yep.
And it seems to me, unless I'm misunderstanding this, that some of what happens is inspired by a different, what, the discipline or a different approach to looking at something, right?
Curious, and you study many more things. You're not this kind of narrowly defined set of perceptions. So
right.
I don't know. I'm just curious about that. It seems like it would make sense.
Did you say curious? Well, you're not using the microphone.
I'm guilty of curious.
Right. So yeah, this is one of my cards in the card deck. Oh, it's in the book.
In the book too. I call it a professional dilettante. Being a dilettante means you learn a tiny little bit about something. Just enough to be dangerous, sometimes people say. So when I say professional dilettante, I mean do that all the time. Keep doing it. Just a little bit about a lot of different things. So yeah, it sounds like it is curiosity, right? But the reason why it enhances creativity is this message I talked about earlier of distant combinations. So the more things you can fill your mind with that are different from each other, the more your possibility is of making those combinations. Even if, like, I don't know, you mentioned, who was it who mentioned accordions? So I've taken up accordion repair. And I just know a little bit. I know no one else in North Carolina does accordion repair. So people are calling me, but I'm a dilettante. And so does that have anything to do with psychological research? No. Nothing whatsoever. I don't think it is. I don't plan for it to. I just think it's kind of cool. I like opening them up. They're weird inside. You know, but that's the way it is when you're becoming the dilettante. Somehow, like I said, you're investing in the future. You trust in the process and that it will eventually lead to new and different kinds of ideas. That's, by the way, that's not why I took up recording. Maybe it's because I'm curious. Okay, you have to pass up the mic.
Thank you. I saw the creative process as part of the human nature.
You create a brain, and that it could work for us to believe that and develop your habits and skills and relax and have fun and all the stuff with the way you live, the way you bring your habits and skills into life.
Right. Well, good. Thank you.
That'll be my last question. I've got a great response. It'll take us out. Plus it's 5:40. But yeah, absolutely. I completely agree with you. Sounds like you knew I was going to agree with you. But yes, creativity is part of being human. In a sense, that's my message, right? That all of us have this power to become more creative. It's the nature of being human. The myths that we have developed about creativity lead us to think it's not for everyone, that it's for these special types of creative people. That's the myth of insight, that big flashes of insight lead to creativity. I don't have big flashes of insight, therefore I'm not a creative person. Myth, right? It's not big flashes, anyone can have them, they're small ideas. That's part of human nature, right? We all make these mental combinations. That's how you get through the day. Every single idea, that everything you do at work is combinations. That's the way thought works. So we know our minds can do that. What gets you to the distant combinations is a set of habits and behaviors, some of which I've been talking about tonight. But yes, we all have that capability. And it's, in a sense, it's the positive psychology too, right? It's human flourishing. It's human nature that we engage in this creativity. And I really do think it's a lot of these myths that get in the way of creativity. The myth of insight, the myth of genius, right? That's a big one. This person is a creative genius, and somehow, again, it's easy for them, because they're a genius. Sorry, that's maybe the bad news, it's hard. But here's another aspect of human flourishing that's tied to creativity, is research on the flow state. This is my doctoral advisor, came up with the concept of flow, but it's a one-syllable version of what psychologists call intrinsic motivation. Intrinsic motivation meaning you're doing something for the sheer joy of engaging in the activity. You're not doing it for external or extrinsic motivation, which would be what, money, or your boss giving you a raise, well, that's money, or saying something nice about you, whatever you think of as external rewards. Intrinsic rewards, something you do just because you love doing. And you get that that feeling of peak performance, that's the flow state. when people are engaged in maximum creativity, they tend to be in a flow state. Engaging in something where you're intrinsically motivated is more likely to lead to a creative outcome. That's a body of research I hadn't told you about before. But yes, absolutely. Intrinsically motivating activities lead to creativity. People who engage in an activity for an external reward are much less likely to be creative. And that's another message about human flourishing and positive psychology. But it's also a message about how to choose your path in life, right? If you're making choices for externally rewarding reasons, it's going to be harder for you to be creative. But if you're making that choice for something that you love doing, that's intrinsically motivating, you're more likely to be creative in that area. Well, thank you very much.